Hello and welcome to A Word from the Wise, the Solwise podcast. We come to you at the end of each month and we talk about all things related to the world of Wi-Fi and the internet. We discuss new products and things going on within the industry and we give advice on how to get the best out of the products that we sell. If you're just listening to us, you can head over to YouTube or Spotify to see the video version of this podcast. And with that being said, please enjoy today's podcast. Hello and welcome to A Word from the Wise podcast from Solwise. It's going to be a little bit different this time because we don't actually have the product. So we're going newsreader style. Mm-hmm. But the product we're going to talk about today is the new SWIRL antenna from Poynting. It's due to be with us in November. So we're going to give you a bit of a heads up, I suppose, on what it does, why you might need it. And then when we do get it, we'll do an unboxing and go back through that again with people. That sounds like a plan, doesn't it?
I think so.
Yeah. So essentially, there's two versions.
Technically, there's four versions.
Well, I suppose if you're going to be pernickety, yes, there's four versions. But there's two versions of antenna, isn't there?
Yeah.
So where are we with that? As far as I can see, there's a 4x4 and an 8x8. So what does that actually mean?
Yeah, so the 4x4... it's only referring to the cellular side of it with them.
Yeah.
Because both of them are 4x4 Wi-Fi.
Right.
But the 4x4 mobile one, it's got four cross-polarized mobile antennas, two horizontal, two vertical.
Yeah.
So that will work with your standard 4x4 router, like the Rotex 50 or C50. And then the 8x8 version, it's just that doubled. So it's four horizontal, four vertical mobile antennas for approximately double the capacity, basically.
So the way that would work then is the 4x4 you would use with one 5G router and the 8x8 you use with two 5G routers.
Ideally, yeah.
So from our range, then you'd be looking at the Teltonika X50 or the C50 in reality.
Yeah, because you really, if you're going to get an antenna like this, you want a proper 5G router to go with it.
Yeah.
And so you'd be looking at either the Rotex 50 or the C50.
And the good thing, now when you said earlier that there's four versions, that was being a bit pernickety. However, it's perfectly true because you can have...
models.
Yeah. Well, it's not because it's the antenna and the base, isn't it? So when the base comes separately, but you can add that base on, can't you? And so the way we've listed it on our website is the four. But it's two parts that you're buying anyway, but we've just kitted them, so that makes life easier for people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so if you get just the antenna version, that's like the top bit, it's all the antennas in this little thing, which can be mounted on top, can be surface mounted with adhesive. See, the adhesive surface mount it comes with, or there's an option to get magnetic mounts to go with it, or it does also have some things in for a proper marine mounting bracket.
Yeah.
But if you get the base to go with it, that base is designed to act as a waterproof enclosure to store routers in to use with it, which means you can use, you know, shorter cables to go to them, so you get less signal loss.
Yeah.
And in with that, it mounts using just the proper marine brackets.
Yeah. Well, you mentioned the cables there, so it's got 65 centimetre cables, hasn't it? So if anybody didn't take the base, they were going to have to get some extension cables in all likelihood to go to wherever their router is. Yeah, that makes sense then. So we've talked about the way that it all is, but the frequency bands, so it covers a whole range of frequency bands for Wi-Fi and 4G, for 5G and the Wi-Fi as well.
Yeah, so for mobile, it's ultra wideband. It's from 600 megahertz to 6,000 megahertz. Obviously, the higher end of that, the 5,000, 6,000 end, that's not really used at the moment, but it's future-proofing for when it eventually is. And it means it covers, you can get a strong signal whether you're close to shore and the signal's nearby, or even if you're quite far out to sea and the signals are only really far away, you can still get those far away long-range ones. And then for the Wi-Fi side of things, it covers up to Wi-Fi 7. So again, that's future-proofing because that's not really used yet. So it means if you get it, then it's going to be covering every kind of frequency you could want, really, for a long time.
All singing, all dancing, this, isn't it?
Yeah. And it does GPS.
And it does GPS.
One GPS antenna.
Yeah.
I think it's 28 dB, so.
Okay. Be interesting to know what the marine people make of that, isn't it? It's because they have all of their separate GPS equipment on their boats. Be interested to know how that might be used. With it being so new, it's not something that we're going to know too much about just yet, but definitely a question for our companies that we deal with. So, which leads us on, I suppose, to who's going to use the SWIRL, because it's being billed as marine or vehicle mount.
Yeah, it's the kind of how the specialisation of how it's designed. It's really probably only going to be worth using for either marine, you know, boats and stuff, probably small to medium sized marine kind of scenarios. You wouldn't have it on a massive...
You wouldn't put it on a ferry, for instance.
No,
but I mean, you might do. You could maybe have a couple on a ferry, couldn't
could
you?
Yeah, could do. Load balancing router.
Yeah.
Probably small to medium sized boats, transportation vehicles maybe you could also use them.
See, I thought that for me, I thought looking at the demographic of the people and small companies that we deal with, you might put it on, say, a canal boat or some of the larger type. I mean, you won't put it on a camper van, but you could put it on one of the larger motorhomes or a lorry or perhaps a bus or something like that. It's quite a neat solution, isn't it?
Very well, yeah.
But the dimensions are on our website, it's a shame we haven't got one, because then people could see it, isn't it? I'm quite looking forward to seeing how
the antenna
how it is
only
in the
version
end.
Is, I think, 1 millimeter shorter than the Mimo 3 range, the shark fin design antennas, which we do a lot of.
Yeah.
So if you get just the antenna version,
then,
it's not too high of a profile, really.
Yeah.
I think if you get it with the base included, it's a bit taller. It's 230 odd millimeters.
If you were going to put it on a vehicle though, on the road, I'm not sure you would take the base though, would you?
Perhaps not.
No, you'd put the cables through and then mount your router inside, I would have thought. It would be the sensible option, I would think, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sorry,
I think it'd be good for the canal boat people though, as we often, if they've got something stuck up and it comes off inside a tunnel, and we often get asked for replacement housings, don't we? So so I think it might be quite good for canal boats, actually.
Yeah.
Remains to be seen. So thinking of the housing, and if it is going to be used out at sea, what rating is that then for use out at sea?
It's got IP69K rating, which is about as good as
you'd
ever need. So it can withstand being submerged in water, it can withstand high pressure jet washes if your boat's being cleaned and the antenna's still on it.
Yeah.
And obviously, even if you get the base version, it's still fully sealed, so you can have your routers and technology, electronic equipment inside it, and that wouldn't suffer anything at all either. And it's UV protected as well, so it's not going to be turned yellow over time by the sun's UV rays. It's still going to look all nice and clean and white.
That does happen as well, doesn't it? As we've had some historically where outdoor devices have gone like that. But the pointing
equipment
stuff has been really good, hasn't it, actually, for not doing that, for having that sort of protection. So I suppose then lastly, price point, where does it fit within our range? Is it like it's kind of like a high end of our standard antennas, and the kind of, I don't want to say low end, but lower end of the posh antennas that they do.
Sort of looks at it as the lowest cost version of their, they have like a three tier big proper marine antenna to hold multiple routers inside antenna range. So the others being the Wavehunter and the Ripple, and they've looked at this as the low cost version of them. But the cost difference is quite substantial, and I think is more substantial than the difference in performance.
Yeah.
So I think it's very reasonably priced for how very good it is.
It's very well specced for its price, isn't it? Yeah. Excellent. Right, well, thank you very much, Daniel. So I'll see you again for part two of this when we get them in November. Right. And and we'll do an unboxing and see what else we've learned from everybody in between that have sold it at the various shows that are going on at the moment. Excellent. Thank you very much.
All right.
Thank you for watching or listening, whichever you chose to do. If you have any podcast ideas for future episodes, please leave us a comment in the section below or even drop us an email to sales@solwise.co.uk. If you've got any specific questions, again, you can pop us an email across. Don't forget to give us a like if you've enjoyed this podcast, and remember to subscribe so you never miss when we upload. Thanks for joining us, and we will see you next month.